Hello friends, welcome back to Engineering Today, and we're back with some exciting updates for you. We'll begin our news with SpaceX's Starship update. After that, we'll briefly talk about SpaceX's acquisition of Swarm Technologies. At the end, we'll take a look at a few points from Musk's interview with Tim Todd. Let's begin our first update based on Starship. On Friday, August 9th, SpaceX gave a glimpse of the complete Starship rocket to onlookers when the company stacked a Starship on the top of a Super Heavy booster for the first time. Having a 165-foot Starship mated with a 230-foot Super Heavy booster officially makes it the largest rocket assembling in history. Later that day, SpaceX lifted Starship S-20 off the booster and transferred it to the high bay. Meanwhile, the Super Heavy booster is removed from the orbital launch mount. Now, SpaceX will need to conduct some tests on both Starship and Super Heavy vehicles prior to its maiden flight. SpaceX CEO Elon Musk previously pointed out some of the tasks that need to be done before the orbital flight, such as adding a heat shield to protect the Super Heavy booster's 29 Raptor engines, some plumbing work, installing the giant mechanical arm to the launch tower, etc. These are undoubtedly crucial, and SpaceX will not launch a Starship if any of the following tasks remain incomplete. Starship S-20 will need to complete the cryoproof testing, which verifies the vehicle condition with liquid nitrogen, simulating the extreme cold of liquid methane and oxygen propellant without the risk of an explosion. SpaceX already has two suborbital Starship launch mounts ready for this purpose. After the cryoproof and hydraulic ram testing is complete, six Raptor engines will be installed in order to conduct the first six Raptor static fire test. On the other hand, Super Heavy Booster 4 will conduct a similar static fire event like the Starship, but with more number of engines. The first set of static fire tests will contain 4 to 9 engines. Lastly, SpaceX will jump into a full 29 Raptor static fire. Both Starship and Super Heavy Booster will need to undergo these tests. Once complete, Starship S-20 will be mated with the Super Heavy Booster for the second time. The Federal Aviation Administration will conduct an environmental review before approving the rocket's launch license. The full-stack Starship, standing around 395 feet, will make the first orbital launch attempt later this year. Stay tuned for the latest updates. Let's move to our next update. SpaceX has made its first public acquisition in the company's 21-year history. The news came on August 6 from the Federal Communications Commission documents that stated that SpaceX has agreed to acquire Swarm Technologies. Swarm Technologies is a satellite communication startup that offers Internet of Things service, IoT, through a smallsat constellation, which has a total 120 active smallsats. It mainly provides a bi-directional communication at low data rates for different markets such as agriculture, energy, and transportation. The startup has raised around $25 million in Series A funding round by launching multiple batches of smallsats. We're at a point now where we're able to put our entire network of 150 satellites for far less than our Series A. Sarah Spangelo, the co-founder and chief executive of Swarm, stated in a webinar. She also talked about the time when the company had about 30 employees and it raised a total of $35 million. In the case of any startup, the investments play a big role in the company's future work, and Swarm managed to turn those investments into actual results by offering commercial Internet of Things connectivity. They also developed Swarm Tile Radio to connect to that network, which comes with a reasonable price. According to the Federal Communications Commission documents, Swarm will transfer its existing satellite and ground station licenses to SpaceX. On July 16th, the company signed a deal based on the acquisition, but it came into public through the Federal Communications Commission filing. So before the filing, both SpaceX and Swarm did not share any details regarding the acquisition. The filing also said that based on the acquisition, Swarm would receive resources to compete against its rival companies. It stated, "Swarm's services will benefit from the better capitalization and access to resources available to SpaceX, as well as the synergies associated with acquisition by a provider of satellite design, manufacture, and launch services. A question remains, that is, how much this acquisition benefits SpaceX? Actually, it's still unclear, as SpaceX did not pass any comments regarding that. Compared to SpaceX's Starlink broadband satellites, Swarm satellites operate in a different frequency band. It will likely provide a very small amount of fees to SpaceX. Apart from that, a big chunk of money will come back to the Starlink beta testers. SpaceX is mainly interested in Swarm's technology. The filing stated, SpaceX will similarly benefit from access to the intellectual property and expertise developed by the Swarm team, as well as from adding this resourceful and effective team to SpaceX. Swarm's custom nanosatellites weigh as little as 0.4 kilograms, or about 0.9 pounds. So in the future, SpaceX might include their Internet of Things service to Starlink satellites. This acquisition will be the key to expand Starlink's potential to maximum. If all goes according to the plan, then SpaceX's Starlink satellites will dominate the global market for satellite communication services. In a webinar, Spangelo talked about the company's long-term goal. She said, "I think we will have launched at least one, if not two, direct constellations. A natural progression would be bigger satellites, or maybe smaller, that can do way more data and connect more types of devices. We definitely have aspirations of additional kinds of demand curves of things that we can do in the future," she added. "You have to stay tuned." A few days back, SpaceX CEO Elon Musk appeared in a three-part interview with one of our favorite YouTube creators, Tim Todd's channel, Everyday Astronaut. And as per the discussion, makes us realize how Musk thrives to achieve new extremes, yet being so simple while discussing about two new Starship and Super Heavy mechanisms. A niche form of aerodynamic control, known as grid fins, was installed in Starship's first Super Heavy booster around the turn of the month. Since 2016, when the original form of Starship were first appeared, these car-sized heavy fins were anticipated. But boosters for grid fins, having no deployment mechanism or retraction, were not expected. Instead, those were fixed in a deployed position after installation. As per Musk, SpaceX has decided to get rid of any known separation mechanism, that too just after performing partial test of the mechanism to combine Starship and Super Heavy together and deploy the ship in flight. According to Musk, going forward the Starship will discontinue to have any separation mechanism, as he finds the entire process is pretty redundant and can be achieved by existing systems, such as boosters gimbaling Raptor engines can be utilized to introduce significant rotation on the rocket just before separation. Super Heavy is capable of snapping away from Starship effectively, from which it's very similar how SpaceX currently deploys Starlink satellites from Falcon utilizing centripetal forces. It spins the upper stage end over, letting the spacecraft float away. This is possible because Starship is 5 times heavier than Super Heavy during the stage of separation. The ship effectively floats away from the booster following a stable linear path. Cold gas thrusters are used to settle its propellant and ignite its 6 Raptor engines to head to orbit. SpaceX can totally preclude the development of a pusher or spring system capable of pushing a 1,300-ton Starship away from Super Heavy if the new approach is found to be effective. This approach is possible on the large part of the Starship, as the ship's 6 Raptor engines are completely tucked away inside a skirt in such a way that there's no chance of the nozzles getting damaged by impacting the booster inner stage. The scenario regarding Super Heavy's grid fins are pretty similar. SpaceX can avoid developing a complex retraction mechanism that keeps a mechanical linkage which is capable to provide enough strength to push and drag such a heavy rocket at hypersonic speeds by having the fins always installed. During the interview, Musk credited another SpaceX employee for this design and hinted he's not the only one behind whatever happens at SpaceX. Thanks for watching. Please subscribe for more videos like this. hit the like button if you find the video interesting, and kindly provide your valuable feedback in the comment section. This will help us to improve.